Well, I think, if I may, I could just at least give my perspective or my story of being introduced to Bella Union and Simon, and even how Jason falls into the story as well. But I'll hopefully, right when I get to that chapter, he walks in. But my name's Eric Polito, and I play in a band called Midlake. And we're from Denton, Texas. It's where we... All right. That's where our band... Sarah, you're supposed to be clapping for Denton. that's where we formed, and all of us in some form or another went through the university there. And we always, you know, wanted to be a band that did it for a living and had no idea how that happens. Still don't even 100% know how that happens, but we would see other bands that we were maybe touring with, crossing paths with, that would get signed to some label, and it just looked like once they got signed, they looked different. Like their hair was just wavier in a better way. The scarf that they were somehow now wearing in 100 degree heat was necessary. And we thought, man, how do we find a label? How do we find people that will put your music out? How do you find a magazine that will review your record? I mean, it was like low-hanging fruit. How do you get a CD pressed, you know? And there was a band called Lift to Experience that was out of Denton, Texas, that we were friends with. And we knew that they were on a label called Bella Union. So right away, anytime we ever heard of a band that got signed to a label, the label became, it didn't even matter how big or small they were, it became Capitol Records to us. It was just like, oh, wow, it's huge. So they told us that they would share our demo that we were working on at the time for an album called Bam Nan and Sliver Cork, which drove Simon crazy at the time, and I understand more now, you know, some 15 years, almost, well, 13 years, 14, I don't know, 14 years later, why. But they sent about 5 songs to Simon, and I think once we found out that they had sent it to him, we got in contact somehow, and Simon wrote back, as we probably bugged him, and said, hey, we heard our demo got sent to you. What do you think, you know? And he said, I want to have Midlake's babies. And we thought, man, that's got to be a good thing. And I mean, any band, you just want to hear someone say yes for once. You know, like, yes, I'll put your record out. Yes, I'll have you play on this stage. Yes, I'll be your agent. Yes, I'll be your manager. Yes, we'll take you on tour with you. And we finally got a yes from a record label, like this enigma of a thing, to put our record out. And Simon, if you know him, you know that he's not just a label head of a record label. He's a lot of things. He's a musician. I mean, he's in the Cocteau Twins, for crying out loud. He is a manager above all managers. He is an agent when you don't have one. But the coolest thing is he became a really dear friend to us. And all this time later, even though there's many stories, maybe some of which we'll get to touch upon and get more in depth with, it was really cool and endearing and I mean, if I may say, magical to finally find someone that cared enough and that stayed on top of it. Because I'll tell you what, that record didn't do so hot. It didn't do very hot at all. It was kind of a bit of a sleeper, but it introduced us to a lot of things that helped set up the next record. And I think if anything I've learned and Simon's taught me is patience. You know, it's patience, it's timing, it's just waiting. And he had patience in us. He had faith in us, and he was willing to fit the bill and really see our band, you know, as we were trying to figure out things as well, where what we would do. And I appreciate that very much, and it's been cool and to see just the years go by and for us to still be together, still be friends, to still be on the label, to still be putting out other projects and to be sitting on this stage together talking about it. Thank you, Simon.
That's okay. Next.
So what's your take on the story? He's like, I don't remember it that way.
Well, it's interesting. It's lovely to hear you say those things. And I think what's interesting is that what year was did I see you? 2003.
Three.
So I mean, you know, I'd barely call us a label at that point in time. You know, I really was I'd only been doing the label for a few years, and to be honest, as a musician, the idea of running a record label was always, you know, miles from our thinking. The only reason we ever started the idea of Bella Union in the first place was because the band we had didn't really fit very well inside record labels. You know, we had terrible experiences, not initially at 4AD, it was very good to start with, but the relationship kind of fell apart, you know, and then we foolishly moved to a major label in the latter stages of our career, and that and many other things, you know, drug problems and relationship problems included, led to the breakup of the band. But just before the band broke up, we thought, you know what, let's start our own little label, our own little imprint, and then we don't have to deal with these people anymore. We don't have to have these breakdown in communications, and we can just do our own thing, find a distributor to put it out, and we can just be masters of our own destiny. So we thought, yeah, let's do that. We were in the middle of making a Cocteau Twins record. I was doing some solo stuff. There were bands coming in our studio. We had a really beautiful studio in the south of England, where it was actually Pete Townsend from The Who's studio, and it was a really gorgeous place to record. You know, right on the river, and you know, really special part of the world to live and to record. So it seemed like the idyllic setup, really. Our own studio, our own label. And then, of course, the band, which was already showing signs of, you know, great stress around the edges, it within 6 months of setting the label up and having a nice logo made and postcards and all that sort of stuff, and members of staff and an office, Elizabeth from the band called me up and said she didn't want to do it anymore. So that's kind of how I'm sitting here right now. It's almost like I can't quite work out what happened, because I don't really like record labels, if I'm honest. You know, I don't really think they do a very good service in general. And I suppose the motivation for continuing to do it was to try and, you know, create a label that I would like to have been on. That's kind of like the ethos of the label, if there is one. So it sort of happened by accident, you know what I mean? And I think in those first few years, we just didn't have a clue what was going on. I didn't know anything about it, because I was a musician and a fairly ignorant musician. Because in those days, remember, there's no internet, there's no computers, really. So there's no way of knowing stuff other than what you get told and what you get passed down. So what we knew was really not very much. We knew the people that we knew, and that was about it. But obviously, over the years, I started to kind of make lots of mistakes and work it out from my mistakes, what worked and what didn't. And when I met you guys, I wasn't confident with the label at that point, but I was certainly more confident than I was, you know, at the start. Yeah, that's kind of about the beginning of when we first hooked up, and I think, as you say, that record was a beautiful introduction, because even though it was a difficult record, if you like, because of the title, I mean, I've never met anyone where I've said the title of their first record and they've gone, oh yes, it's a very obstructive title, Bam Nan and Sliver Cork. So I mean, what the fuck does that mean? Do you know what I mean? It's like,
there is a story.
Well, yeah, but nobody cares, because you're a brand new band.
Did they care about the artwork done on Windows paintbrush, though?
No, they didn't care about that either. That's always been a sore point. But the thing is, you know, they were such an amazing band. I think, joking aside, what I could see, even at that age, was such enormous potential, which was very quickly realized with the second record, The Trials of Anarchy Panther.
Which incidentally was going to just be called Van Occupanther, and Simon said, oh shit.
No, that's not true.
I said, what if I talked him into doing some type of preface, like to make it so you knew it was a person's name, the Trials of, and it was like, all right.
Well, wasn't it the Triumphs and Trials?
There was a lot of different things.
It was even worse than it was then, but
yeah.
It was such an incredible record when we got it, and I think one of the motivations of continuing with Bella Union is partly at the time when I was struggling the most was the not the failure, because it wasn't a failure, it was an incredible record, but I felt that record should sell 1 million copies, you know? And I know one always says that when you put out a record, you know, oh, I think this is going to do 1 million records. I actually genuinely believe that it had the crossover potential to do that. You know, I felt the press really loved it. I felt radio really loved it. And when it didn't sell 1 million records, I felt sort of really frustrated about that. And it actually drove me on, probably more than you realize. You know, it was a real catalyst to me thinking, okay, you know, we should have done way better with that record than we did. It did sell well. That's not in doubt. But, you know, I felt it could have done way, way, way better. And I think whilst you still have that hunger and that desire to make things better in your career, as a musician or as a label person or as a press person, whatever, if you still wake up in the morning thinking that you could do better and it could, you know, you could do better stuff, then I think you've got a chance of making it. As soon as you do something and you think, well, that's as good as it's going to get, then really I think you should probably give up and do something else. Because you need that hunger and that desire to just keep pushing yourself. And thankfully, I've never really been that happy with anything we've done as a label. Well, happy, but, you know, I want it to be amazing, and that's what sort of keeps me getting up in the morning.
Well, and I think, you know, if I may, what's been cool from our perspective is just seeing all the bands that come over to Bella Union. So obviously many that start there, but many that come over as kind of orphans, because Simon said it, he looked at it as he's just a band, he's an artist, that's how he thinks first. A lot of labels don't do that, for better or worse, however you want to look at the equation, but an artist wants to feel appreciated, understood, so it's great, because he, even though he does come from an artist perspective, I think he understands the dynamics of it, because that is a very difficult thing. And that's why I love to talk with younger bands. Not that I have the ingredient or the equation, but you can empathize, you know, and kind of talk through it and work through those things of finding those people. It doesn't always have to be a label. It could be another band. It could be a manager. It could be, you know, a promoter or whatever, different folks, and you create relationships. And you realize, as I have, that it's actually a much smaller world than I realized at the time, you know. And, you know, how you are, who you are, you know, the relationships that you create, I think goes a long way. And that is a testament. You see all these artists. I mean, Father John Misty, Fleet Foxes, Flaming Lips, Explosions in the Sky, Beach House. I mean, all these great bands. And what's cool about that for us, and there's a slew of other ones, Bella Union always did a really good job of making it feel like a family. It wasn't just a business. It's not just a business. Of course, that has to be a part of the diagram, but the family aspect was so cool, because we would just tour together a lot of times with other Bella Union bands, and we'd go out on a bus together. Because why not? It's a lot more fun. You get tired of one another, you know, especially us mid-late guys. So we'd have other Bella Union artists come out on tour with us, and it would almost be like this this Bella Union review, you know, of going out. And it's some of the most fondest memories. And we still do that. And other bands, Bella Union bands, do the same thing. And then you end up collaborating. And all these years later, I mean, we had a gal that did strings on the Banquet record that was a part of an artist touring company 10 years later. You know, I mean, it's just kind of cool to see all that and the foundation of that really being Bella Union.
I think it's important. It's really important to me, because I've always been told when I was making music as a teenager and in my early 20s that, you know, you couldn't mix business and pleasure, and you couldn't, you know, you had to keep the two things apart, and you couldn't manage somebody that you were releasing, and you couldn't. And I just thought, you know, what a load of rubbish that was. I just think if you're honest and moral and humble and you want to help, then what your title is, it really shouldn't make any difference at all. So I've always sort of liked that family analogy, because it does, you know, my wife and I, Abby's in the audience, of course, she's such a huge part of what I do at the label. And we do love that aspect to Bella Union, and I think it does make it different. It's not like we set out to have a family; it's worked out that way. We don't do this for a job; it's our life. You know, everything we do is about either making music, which I've returned to doing a lot more recently, which is very, very important right now, having, you know, pretty much had 20 years where I haven't really done much. And helping young artists that have, like, not really achieve their aims, because that's not really down to me solely, but it's helped them not feel so sort of alien inside this business, because it really is a very strange business. It's like no other. And as a young artist, it can be super confusing. You know, you can very easily end up with the wrong people without even realizing it until a couple of years down the line, where you're like, what have I done, you know? Sometimes even longer. I mean, we had a manager in our day. I'm not going to disrespect him. Well, okay. I guess I will, just by the fact that I'm talking about him. But, you know, we had a manager that we kind of put a lot of trust into. We didn't have any manager for 8 years, and then we fell into this relationship with this guy who was much, much older than us. He was like our dad, because none of us had dads. So we felt very comfortable with this kind of older, wiser person. And we just sort of let him get on with stuff, and unfortunately that was a really big mistake. Because I think as an artist, if you take your eye off the ball, and we didn't deliberately take our eye off the ball. It was just we were juggling drug habits and rehab and babies and relationship fallouts. And we were kind of trying to keep the band together. So we kind of left this manager to do his thing. And then when we sort of found out what he was doing that was not really cool at all, it was a massive shock, you know. And it was probably another part in the nail in the coffin, really, of the band. So I'm always nervous with young artists and them jumping into bed with management. Whilst I'm not anti-managers, of course not. There are some amazing managers out there, and I'd have to say the best successes on Bella Union are all with managers who are amazing, because they bring added value to the game. You know, because I can only do so much. I'm not. You know, I don't have the power to do everything. And you know, a great manager really does add so much to the campaign, but we didn't have that, and I'm always a little frightened with young artists who just jump in bed with a manager, not actually physically into bed with, although, you know, I'm sure some do. That can be dangerous, you know. It's a tricky one. You don't want to sort of give someone too much control over your career, but at the same time, you're at that vulnerable point as an artist where you really want some help. And if someone offers some and they seem like a cool person, it's very, very easy to find yourself in a relationship that you know. And the other thing is you don't know that it goes wrong until it goes wrong.
Yeah, we went through several over the years, and it, you know, part of it, I will say, part of it in our relationship with Simon and Bella Union for a long time, like, that's all we knew. And it was a good foundational thing. It was a good precedent to set as we were kind of building the team, as it were, you know. And we didn't really know how to solidify those things, so Simon helped with those. We still have the same agent in the UK that we had for the rest of the world outside of America. We had our US agent for a long, long time, and he was really close with us. And the manager side of it, though, as Simon said, can be a bit of a thing where between the band and the label and just whatever your agenda is and how you see things and how you operate with one another. I remember when we had gotten out of one relationship with a manager, Simon had suggested a person that a part of the reason was just his own demeanor, you know, of just how he dealt with people. And there's, I don't think there's any right or wrong. We've had the more aggressive kind. We've had the more passive kind. It really just takes someone that cares and gets up. I always tell a band, you know, when they're kind of say, like, I'm just going to put it out on iTunes. I'm going to do this or that myself. And I'm like, all right, well, every day you better be thinking, okay, how do I, you know, help my band to get to the next level or succeed or put my art out there? And then even when you do solidify those things, an agent, a manager, a label, you still better be thinking that or wondering if they're doing that. And it can be frustrating, but I always feel like there should be a balance within a band. We were lucky enough to have a band with a lot of different minds, a lot of different strengths that, okay, Paul, he's a great bass player, but he can also change a tire. All right, that's good to have in a band, you know. You know, I think it just helps, and to have a label that is responsive, that you know. I mean, we all have relationships. It's no different from any other work relationship, but with this, you kind of have, as Simon said, I want to put out your babies. Okay, if I'm going to have a baby, well, I want to make sure that baby is nurtured and cared for and paid attention to, because I feel there's always a window once you say, okay, we're going to do it. And that's why patience, I think, is a big thing. This is when the album comes out, okay, the build up, then the window, it just starts kind of closing, you know? So I feel like it's very important to get those ducks in a row, to have those things together. And, you know, Simon taught me a lot of what I know in those ways. And I've really appreciated it for our band, but also for others, because that's where part of the reason why we got where we were, is other bands helping us, you know? So.
Yeah, I think one of the cool things about the label is just, you know, it, as I say, it is like my life, really, but it's also given me some incredible relationships and friendships over the years with you guys for however long it's been. 15 years, is it?
Yeah.
You know, with Beach House since 2006, we put out every record they made. Explosions in the Sky, Dirty Three, we've been working since 1998. John Grant, of course, the Czars, we started working in 1998. So I like the artist development side of what I do. I like the idea of finding an artist and trying to help them get somewhere, whether it's, you know, just like very small steps at a time. It's a beautiful thing when it works. Of course, there's, for all the great success stories which you mentioned, mustn't be forgotten, there's an awful lot of artists that it didn't work out for. You know, and you have to take the good with the bad, and you have to accept that, you know, you can't get it right every time. And my attitude is, well, if I get it right slightly more than I get it wrong, which I've been doing lately, then I'll be able to sit here for a few years longer. But I may well have a patch where it doesn't go my way, you know, and that's probably not going to be down to the quality of the artist that we sign. It may just be down to, oh, here's our friend. Hey, it's Jason Lee, everyone. So, yeah, how are you doing?
It took me about an hour just to find parking, and I was in the city for an hour, and it took me an hour to find parking.
It took me half an hour to find this room from entering downstairs, so
oh,
you didn't do so bad. Well, we've been talking about you, basically.
I hope not.
All the things we're not so sure about. Yeah, we've just been talking about like the label and how we got here, really, and what a funny, strange journey it's been.
A good segue may be something I left out with an earlier story, and then Jason comes a part of the story in a subsequent South by Southwest. But I told you that Simon had sent an email saying he wanted to have Mid Lakes Babies. Well, of course, usually a label or an agent or manager, whatever, you want to see the band live to make sure that whatever you're hearing on a recording is at least somewhat close to the same, you know, when you know, semblance of that when you hear it live. So it was South by Southwest, 2004. Well, was yours was three, Jason's was four. So three happened just to figure out if indeed, you know, Simon was going to put the record out, which was a kind of a constant theme. Like, are you still our record label even after the first record? We didn't really sign anything per se, you know. So we played the gig just over here, and Simon and the Bella Union gang from that time come rolling in, and they missed the gig altogether because one of the gals that worked for the label got drunk on the plane. Do you remember that?
This story, if I get into that story, we'll still be here tomorrow morning.
Okay.
Because, yeah, basically a girl worked in my office. She got arrested on the plane. If you can even get arrested on a plane. I didn't know you could, but she got put in handcuffs and feet cuffs. She was, like, paralytic by within about half an hour of the plane taking off. And, I can't even get into that story because it's too funny. It'll just dominate the proceedings. But just that is why we missed the show, because I was either giving her marching orders, as it were, or she was drunk somewhere and I had to fish her out of some other bar. Because even though she was so apologetic the next morning, I was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry, I'm so embarrassed. Because she came to our showcase drunk, you know, and I'd never seen her outside of the office. In the office, she was always awesome. But obviously away from the office, she had a bit of a problem, you know, and she was a total mess. And I said, look, I'm not going to do anything while we're away because I just wanted to get on and enjoy my week because you've kind of already ruined my week. But
luckily, he put out the record sight unseen, regardless. So I don't think he saw us until like a show in London, maybe that next year. But the next year, 2004, Simon's always been really good, as I said, as a label, as a manager hat, of sharing, you know, music with tastemakers, with people that you could collaborate with, videographers, photographers. Agents, you know, other bands, and unbeknownst to us, you know, and that's for us when Jason entered the story, which was 2004, which was before the record came out. He was just sending that record, Bam Nan and Slivercork, out to friends that he knew. I didn't know Jason. I didn't know Simon's Rolodex in any way, but always, you know, was in awe of just him sharing, you know, what we were doing.
Jason had written to me, I think you wrote to me, did you?
I emailed Simon just as a massive Cocteau Twins fan because my friend David Jansen, he somehow had Simon's email address. Yeah. And I was a Cocteau Twins fan in 1988. I had gotten the record Bluebell Knoll, which is still one of my favorite records of all time. Probably still my favorite band of all time, Cocteau Twins. And I just emailed him and said, hey, I'm just this guy that knows David Jansen, and is it okay that I'm emailing you? I'm just a huge fan. And Simon was very, very cool and emailed me back, and he started sending me CDs. And in the first box of CDs, it was the Explosions in the Sky CD and Bam Nan and Slivercork, the first Midlake CD. And then, so I was a huge Midlake fan. I loved the Explosions in the Sky stuff. And then I was shooting a movie here in 2004, and South by Southwest was happening, and I found these guys playing, and I fanned out on them for a long time, and we became friends, and then I made a music video for them, and it just kind of started from there. So I kind of owe I first owe my girlfriend when I was 18 for buying me that CD, and then David Jansen for introducing me to Simon. Yeah.
And it was a surreal thing for us, you know, small town Texas boys coming down to Austin and finding out that an actor that we really respected and loved was fanboying about us rather than the other way around. Like, it's not supposed to be working this way, and as people are coming up and, you know, taking pictures with Jason, and he's saying, do you guys know Midlake? You know, they've got a great record coming out. And he's still like that today. He honestly is one of the greatest champions of art and just people's art. So
Simon is the same way.
That.
That's what I appreciate so much about Simon. You like something and you just sign the person. I like the Holly story.
Yeah.
Right? Just being into something and still having that connection to, and then that's first before the logistics get sort of thought about.
Yeah,
and then that
I've
sort of becomes
that
the easy part.
I've
just
about that
taking
lot.
Risks and being into it because of how something feels.
Yeah, I couldn't really be any other way. I mean, I quickly realized that, you know, business was not my, you know, interest or my strong suit, really. And I surrounded myself with people that knew more about that kind of stuff than I did after a while when I worked out that that was important too. But as far as, like, signing bands, I haven't a clue what will sell or how well something will do. I mean, I don't really care, to be honest. I mean, obviously, I want it to do well, but, you know, my prime motivation to sign an artist is how does it make me feel, you know?
Simon does always respond with if he doesn't want to do something, he'll say, I don't love it. Which I don't know if you know this, but we started in our own little group. We started to have our own little Simon quote of, I don't love it. Like, so if someone would ask, I think Robert Gomez might have actually coined that. He got a lot of time on the bus sometimes to come up with things.
God, what do you think? I'm going to get paranoid about writing that again because I do say that. I say, thank you very much for sending me your CD. I don't love it, but I do like it, but it's just not my sort of
but
thing.
But that's a great thing because he has to love it. And if he loves it, like you should do, you share it. You want it to grow. You want to nurture it. You want it to make it something cool. And of course, like he said, you never know. You don't have a crystal ball. But I always, it feels good when Simon likes something. It gives to me, it almost kind of validates, like, all right, Simon likes it. It must be all right.
I think to do this job, like, you know, all of us do, you know, you got to have confidence in your own taste, you know, and your confidence in your opinion. And if somebody asks me, what do you think about my music, I just tell them. I mean, I'm not going to be brutal for the sake of it, even if I really hate it, but I'll probably try and find something positive to say. But I really think it's important just to look people in the eye and tell them why it's not your thing or why you don't like it or what you do like about it. Because even in the negative, there can be something an artist can take away. And I don't answer every single email that artists send me because I just couldn't. Because I get a lot of what stupid ones where they put every label in the world on CC, you know. And I know it's not to me. I know it's just to everybody. So I don't bother responding to those ones. But the ones where people actually make an effort to contact me and say they like the label or something, I will always listen and respond. And 99 times out of 100, you know, it won't lead to anything. But I think that's really important for artists to understand that a small label is going to at least fucking listen to the thing, because it's demoralizing to have to send out so many emails. See, in the old days, CDs, cassettes. I mean, John Grant, that's a great story. I'll tell you very briefly. John Grant, obviously, we work with still today, and he's one of our most successful artists. He sold out Royal Albert Hall recently in the UK. He's, you know, probably bigger in Europe than he is here. But when he sent me his first cassette, which was in 1998, it was in a letter, you know, with a pen, because I think he was on email at that point. And I mean, I wrote back and I just said, I quite like your voice. We've talked about this since, so it's okay for me to tell you. I quite like your voice, but I just don't think the songs are very good. And, you know, you should continue for sure. Because I think he'd sort of said, do you think I'm any good at this? Is there any point in me bothering? And I was like, yeah, continue. But like, I'm not ready to sign you at this point because I don't think your songs are quite there yet. And he wrote me back about a month later and sent me another cassette. And it wasn't really that much better, to be honest, but his voice was quite a bit better. He'd been singing a lot more. The band was still a bit ropey. But to cut a long story short, you know, he did keep persevering. And at some point, maybe about a year later, I was like, you know what, John? I think this is really not bad. I think you could, why don't you come over, I'll bring the band over to the UK, to the studio, and I'll produce your first record in our studio. Because having your own studio means you can do that kind of thing, and it's not really going to cost you an arm and a leg. And I brought them in, and that was the first Zaz album. Okay, it didn't do that great. Neither did the second one, neither did the third one. But the John Grant story, which of course you were a massive part of, and I'll be always eternally grateful to you guys for what you did for John Grant, because no way would he be in the position he is without the record you made with him and the friendship and love you showed him at a time when he was, you know, suicidal. Let's not beat about the bush. And I think those stories are why I love doing what I do, because it is, as I said before, it's not really just a job. It's certainly not a job. It's a way of life, and you can't have people in your life for that long if they're not willing to put themselves out there, you know, and you guys did with John, and his rise to the success he is at, you know, is in great part down to that relationship.
Well, and I think you touched upon it earlier of how many artists, not just on Bella Union, but as a whole, that are amazing that you just may never hear of just because luck didn't have it, you know? And he was definitely a story of perseverance because he kept at it. Even when the band that was the thing that got signed didn't work out, he kept at it. It was still a part of him. I mean, we used to go, every time we'd go over to Europe, we'd start in London, we'd fly into London, we'd show up at the Bella Union office. And my favorite thing to do was to go raid Simon's vinyl shelf that had Cocteau Twins stuff a part of it too. So I have some cool things I've stolen.
That's why I don't have any Cocteau Twins yeah. records in my collection, because you have them all.
Well, he has
all
great
the test collection. Pressings, all the early. Yeah. Thanks for that.
But a part of that was also the Czars, and I loved the Czars. I thought their records were just great. And as chance would have it, we met John also at South by Southwest. It was a weird, it was actually under the Czars moniker, but it was just he and another guy. And it was a weird lineup because it was the Czars, Midlake, no, sorry. Yeah, no, it was the Czars, Flaming Lips, and then Midlake, which it wasn't because that we should have been last. It's just timing had it that way. So it was kind of an odd lineup to have this confetti and smoke and jubilation. And then we get up, it's like, hey, we're not going to have any three of those things. There might be some, you know, minor key tunes, some dirges. But it was funny because John, if you know him, he's kind of got this dark comedy thing, you know, it epitomizes it in a lot of ways, but he's just a kind of a gentle giant of a guy, and you fall in love with him. Self-deprecating, you know, individual, but intelligent and just endearing and funny. And we went to eat just down the street on Congress with Simon and John, and we fell in love with this guy. Like, who is this guy? We love your music. We're going on about it. And he's like, oh, this, that, or the other. So we were going to go on a tour, and John was in New York. He was a translator, a Russian translator at a hospital, strangely enough.
Yeah, but hold on a minute. He was translating Russian medical dictionaries into German. He wasn't just a Russian yeah. translator.
Russian to German.
You know, that's just to give you an indication of how bilingual John Grant is. That's what he was actually doing.
Yeah. And I think he's picked up about 3 or 4 languages since
no,
as well.
About 12.
Yeah, okay. And he'll just say, well, once you learn a few, it's easy to learn more. Like, okay. I won't go on too long about the story, but we took him out on tour as a solo artist and fell in love even more with the guy and just encouraged him to keep going and told him just to come to Denton, which is kind of a familiar thing. I like folks to come to Denton, to come to town and you know, break bread, make music. And John was one of those. We were making an album called The Courage of Others, which was kind of difficult, and so by night we would make the record with John. And his album was a lot more fun, you know, to make. And he made The Queen of Denmark there in Denton at our studio. And if anything, it was us, it was a collaboration to show how great he is. I mean, we were the band, but this is John's voice. This is his songs. This is his brainchild, you know, and he's obviously gone on with two subsequent records, tours, collaborations to say, man, this guy now is in full swing. And you got to understand, for those that are wondering, like, well, is it too late? Like, he did his first solo record at 42 or 43.
42. But yeah. Well, I should just say, because I know there's quite a few musicians and artists in the audience, and it's a really beautiful thing to think that we all know that when you sort of get to a fork in the road in your life, and you could go down there and you could go down there, and whichever way you go will determine kind of what happens to you. And the John Grant story is pivots on this moment when the editor of Mojo magazine, which back in the early part of the century was a huge magazine. Print magazines don't really sell quite as well as they did because of the internet now, but back in 2010 when John's record came out, Mojo was selling like 100,000 a month. One of the most important magazines. And I had invited the editor of the magazine to my office in Hackney in East London to listen to The Courage of Others, the mid-late record which had just been finished. And I wanted him to be the first person to hear it because I knew, if he get it early and he kind of jumps on board before anyone else, it would have a sort of knock-on effect and help the band's career. So we're listening through this record, and he's loving it, and he's like, "Oh man, thank you so much. I'm definitely going to do a feature on Mid Lakes." So I was like, "Great, job done, ambition achieved." And then he was just on his way out the door, and I was like, "Oh shit, I must play him some of the John Grant." They hadn't finished the John Grant record yet. Mid Lake and John Grant made this album together called The Queen of Denmark, as Eric's just been saying. They sent me some rough mixes, and I had two in that room. And he was on his way out the door, and I said, "Phil, could I just keep you back for like 2 minutes? I just want to play you something. Do you remember the Czars?" And he was like, "Yeah, kind of vaguely." And I said, "Well, Midlake have been making this record with the singer of the Czars. I just wanted to play you something because I think you could really love it." So I played him a track called TC and Honey Bear, and another track, was it Where Dreams Go to Die?
Yeah, that was on there.
Okay, Mars. Yeah, that's it, Mars. I played in these two songs, quite rough mixes, and he kind of went really quiet. He went really silent, and he was sort of a bit teary. And I was like, "I was all right, it was like getting cold or something." And I said, "Are you okay?" And he was like, "Simon, that is like one of the best things I've heard. Tell me more." So I told him a bit about the story, and he said, "That's brilliant. Listen, good luck with it and keep me posted." So, had I just forgotten that to bring him back into the room, John may not, I'm not saying that it was all, it was the most important thing, but I really do believe that because what happened next was he called me up and said he wanted to do a little 10-minute Q&A with John. He would just put a little poster and saying, "John Grant's gone solo, he's got this record coming out, could I do a 10-minute Q&A with him, because he'd love these tunes." I said, "Yeah, of course." So he did the Q&A, and then I spoke to him about a month later and asked him how the interview with John Grant had gone on the phone. And he said, "It was pretty amazing, to be honest." He said, "We were on the phone for 4 hours. I was like, "Oh my God, I'm sorry, was it okay?" Because I knew that John was like quite hot, in a sort of confessional frame of mind at that point, because he was sort of out of therapy, and he needed to talk about his problems, quite rightly so, and he said it was beautiful. He said I was like his therapist. That's what Phil, the editor of Mojo, said. I loved it. I couldn't write any of it because it was too personal. It was too brutal. The shit he was telling me was just, I couldn't transcribe it. He started transcribing the piece, "Hey John, how are you doing? Where are you from? What's the record about?" And then after like 15 minutes, he was like, "I'll put the pen down. I'm just going to talk to John, man to man." And it ended up with this full-page feature on John Grant. Remember, this is a 42-year-old guy in a band that nobody had given a fuck about for 8 years, putting out his first solo record that really could have just fallen under the radar. But because he connected with those songs in that room at that moment, then connected with John on a face-to-face kind of basis with this interview, he decided, you know what, I'm going to make that album of the month in Mojo. That doesn't sound like such a big deal, but believe me, album of the month in Mojo at that period of time was like winning a Grammy. You know, it just meant everything. And it got us off to such a strong start. A full page piece on the one page and a full page illustration of John on the other. For a brand new artist, this kind of stuff does not happen to brand new artists unless there's some serious money from Warner's behind it. You know, that for a little label like ours to get that kind of boost to a career. And all because he just didn't leave the room at that moment when I thought he was going to. I just remembered to grab him back. And it's sometimes you just look back to those moments and you're like, fuck, thank God I asked him back in the room. Or else it could have been two or three albums before people quite kind of got into John. So I don't know what the moral of the story is. I guess just don't let people leave the room.
I think it's a testament to just to helping and sharing and I think that goes a long way because I think especially nowadays, you know, there's a lot of just jaded folks and things just kind of, they do fly under the radar and it kind of goes through the grinder of sorts of saying like, well, this is how you do it and just goes through that. And if that equation doesn't work, well, then on to the next. I mean, even us teaming up with John, a big part of that was because so many folks, you know, this was just, again, we fell in love with the guy. We wanted to do a solid for him. It wasn't like, oh, how can we make tons of money off of John? Okay, it's going to cost you, you know, thousands. Like, no, let's hang out. Well, where do I live? You're going to live at my house. Well, you're going to get tired of me. Like, after I get tired of you, you can go live at Tim's house. But, you know, Jason was that to us a long time before that. When that album that I was talking about flew under the radar, before Van Occupanther had even come out, Jason was on a talk show because he's a famous actor and go on a talk show, and he said, hey, Craig Kilborn, or Craig Ferguson, these guys are going to come on the Late Late Show with me. And luckily, he was into it and allowed it. And then he said, hey, Stereo Skateboard Company that I own, Midlake's going to play the show. We're going to fly him over to London. They're going to do a show. And then they're going to go back to L.A., and we're going to do it there. And then I'm going to go to Denton, and I'm going to shoot their first video for a song called Balloon Maker. And then I'm going to do a photo shoot. I'm going to put it in a magazine that I contribute to. I probably have a debt that Jason has written down, like, you owe me a lot, man. Because he's done that a lot. And I think my point is that because folks like Jason and Simon have been so kind to us, It's like if you're in the line for a coffee or whatever and someone pays it forward, you know, and says, all right, what did the person behind me get?
Like, you know. But there is something to be learned in this because I think for young artists, it's really important to realize that the reason we've all stayed such great friends, you know, is for these reasons that we've met, is because there's a mutual respect there and we're not dicks. You know, I think if you're a musician and you just have this attitude or arrogance about you, it'll get you so far, you know, but I think it's really important not to be a dick in the music business these days, and there's no need to be anymore. You know, it's very hard to survive in this business, certainly to make any money out of it. It's almost impossible. You know, I'm sure there's plenty of musicians in this room who are, like, you know, fucked up to the eyeballs with debt and, you know, dental bills and God knows what. You know, it's a struggle, but that doesn't mean to say you have to be an asshole about things. You know, if you're just humble and kind and thoughtful, it gets you so much further, I think. And I guess you must meet a lot of people in the film business, Jason, that where you wish that was advice they were given to.
I live in Texas now. That should answer your question.
Well, okay, fair enough.
Should we take a question or two with the last minutes that we have left?
Oh,
we have
sure.
A clock here right in front of us that says...
Oh, wow, we haven't got much
time
left.
It's like the wrap it up clock.
Okay, yeah, so if anyone wants to ask any pertinent questions, it'll be difficult for the first person to ask because you'll feel shy. But once one person's gone, it generally kind of frees everyone else up to do it. Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes. Recently I pursued a band called Grizzly Bear, who, why is that funny? Because they're awesome? Yeah, they are. I flew to New York hoping to sign them, but I do believe that I didn't achieve my aim. Pursuit of bands. I tell you what, I flippantly said once upon a time, somebody said, doing an interview, dream artists for Bell Union. I said, well, number one, Patti Smith. And we just recently released a Patti Smith record. So that was like, holy, I still like, when I see it in the collection, I'm like, wow, fuck, we've released a Patti Smith record. I can't even believe it. And then she signed loads of copies. So I'm just pleased I've managed to get one. It's really... That's one of the proudest things, to be able to put out a record by people you admire. And it's beautiful since the success of Fleet Foxes, which obviously drew a lot of attention to the label and made people realize that, you know, we were, you know, not just a kind of cool indie, we were actually capable of selling a million records, you know. Once we were put on that map, I think lots of other artists came to us rather than us going looking for them. Because I'm not very good at like blowing my own trumpet, really. I just sort of prefer it if someone contacts me, you know, and then we can have a friendship or something. And that happened with Flaming Lips, obviously, after Fleet Foxes, when they decided they didn't want to be on Warner's in Europe anymore. They looked around, I guess, and they saw that what we do, and they decide they want to put records out with us. That feels great, for sure it does. But pursuit of other artists. Have I forgotten anyone, Abby? That we can talk about? Yeah. I don't think so. Grizzly Bear's the most recent one. That's why I remembered it, because I don't usually like fly halfway across the world to try and sign a band. But I was invited to the studio to listen to the new record, and which, by the way, should anyone care what I think about it, is absolutely stunning. It's definitely one of their best records. But yeah, sometimes you don't get what you want. You know, that's life. Yeah.
Well, my question is similar to his. He asked, you know, did you ever pursue a band not able to sign? Did you ever have an opportunity to sign a band and then you passed on it and then later?
Yes. Ivo.
Mm-hmm. He said that his greatest regret was that he had an opportunity to sign DJ Harvey and he passed on it. And then he spent years regretting that. Is there any situation like that? Is that a band you have a chance to sign and you didn't?
Certainly, had artists, you know, who I really liked, who when I heard the record, I had to be honest and say no. Because the thing is, yes, you can sign an artist that you really admire. And I suppose you could put the record out and you know, take whatever luck you can get with it. But I just can't do that. I can't put out something I don't really love. I'm just rubbish at it. Because I can't, you know, you got to take that record into people and tell them how amazing it is. And if you don't think it's amazing, then you're going to do a really shit job at promoting it, aren't you? So I'm like, I'm sorry, I just didn't really get the record. So I've turned down a few that I probably, in hindsight, on a business side, should have maybe considered, but I don't have any regret about it because I know it was the right decision for me. Anthony and the Johnsons. I heard his first record, very first record, and I just didn't get it, you know. And I mean, I'm the hugest Anthony and the Johnsons fan now, but do I regret it? No, not really, because, you know, I didn't get it at the time and I didn't think it was amazing. So you can't regret something, you know, if your reaction to it was genuine. Anyone? Yeah. Oh, was that a hand or just a nose wipe?
I can ask.
Oh, you go ahead.
What's your favorite Cocteau Twins?
Ask Jason. He has loads.
Are you a Cocteau Twins fan? A kissed out red float boat.
I think my favorite probably is one with a sort of like fairly extravagant title. It's called Frou Frou Foxes in Midsummer Fires.
That's a good one, yeah.
That one and a song called Alice. Those two were written on piano. I wrote them on piano like shortly after my father died. So I kind of... That record is an interesting record having Las Vegas because when we made it, Elizabeth and Robin had recently had a baby, and my dad just died quite young. So there was like, you know, extreme emotions inside that record, birth and death. And I think it's probably an emotional record for a lot of people because there were so many emotions flying around in the studio, you know. Because we don't really write songs in the way that I now know other people write songs, you know, like with a guitar and work out chords and the melody. We tended to write like instrumentals. Me and Robin would write the instrumentals, fully finish them as pieces of music, and there would be almost like an album's worth of instrumentals. And then Elizabeth would come in when they were all finished and put her vocals on. Not 100% improvised, but like certainly there was a lot of kind of... freeform kind of approach to it. You know, she kind of heard them in the other room through the wall kind of thing, and then would come in and just sort of let go, you know. And it, recording Elizabeth Fraser was right up there with the most beautiful things I've ever done in music. Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. One of the greatest men in rock and roll, Jeff Travis from Rough Trade. Thank you. The Will Stratton show that the other day, just now. Oh, well, we went to see Will Stratton last night. He played in a hotel at the Intercontinental, which is probably one of the most soulless places to perform a concert. Because, you know, listen, you've all been to South By. There's an awful lot of good things about it, but there's an awful lot of bad things about it. Holly McVie, who's not here right now, but she played again like Will Stratton today in an environment that is just not really conducive to acoustic singer-songwriters. And it's, if there are any of you in the room that do make music like that, you know, my heart goes out to you if you perform at a festival like this, because unless you're playing at St. Bethel's Church or the Central Presbyterian Church, you know, you're in for a fuck of a ride, you know what I mean? Because no one's going to be listening, really. Maybe three people down the front. And the annoying thing is that the people at the back don't realize that those three people down the front really, really, really want to listen. And it's a massive struggle to be an acoustic artist at South By. So I really applaud all those people that make the effort to do it. And I think... Because I know when you're doing it, you're looking out into the audience and you hear all this screaming and chatter, and you're probably thinking, what in God's name am I doing here? I would really be better off just staying at home. And I say to all those artists, like, you know, no, you cannot think like that, because today is a perfect example of how awesome South By can be. Today, Holly McVie played at a party. I won't name the party. She played at a party this afternoon. And I swear to God, I could barely hear her music because of the... It was down in, where was it? Rainy Street, where there was all the kind of huge, big parties going on with the massive, big PAs. So there she is, this fragile little thing with this gorgeous voice, just like Will in the hotel, and there's this pounding, like, beats and... You know, I don't even know how you concentrate enough to sing the tune, but she just got into the zone, closed her eyes, sang the songs. I looked across to who was down the front near where I was. I was trying to give her a bit of comfort by being at the front. And then I see this writer called John Perelis from the New York Times, one of the most brilliant writers in America about music. Been around for an awful long time. Used to write for Time Out in New York. Great, great man. I could see him writing notes. I was like, really wanted to look at what he was writing, but I was standing on the wrong side. I was praying that he was writing something positive. And I went up to him. I wasn't sure if he'd remember me because we had met many years ago. He was a Cocteau fan as well. And I went up and said, "Hey, John, it's Simon." He said, "Oh." He said, "Great idea to put her in a venue where you couldn't hear a fucking note." And I was like, "Totally, totally, totally." He said, "She is incredible." He said, "How she pulled that off, I don't know. If you can sing in front of that, with that beautiful voice, you can sing anywhere." And that was a very, very heartening thing. And I always say to Holly, I say to the young artists that we work with, whenever I get the opportunity to sing, like, you know, that the most important person in the room is right in front of you somewhere. Because even if there's 100 people talking, one person might be the person that makes a big difference in your career. And I'm not saying John Perelis is going to put her on the front page of the New York Times, but I know he's going to write something super positive. And at a time when one could have thought, this is the most stupid thing that she could possibly have done, play this show where no one gives a fuck, no one can even hear her sing, there was one person in the audience who did pay attention and did love it. And this is a very long answer to your question, Jeff, but... Yes. Well, Will Stratton is playing in about 5 minutes at the Westin Hotel, in another hotel, where I'm sure by the end of that show he'll be wondering again what the hell the point, meaning of life is. But if you can rush over to see him, one of the best songwriters in America right now, and you probably won't realize that till several years down the line, but believe me, I haven't heard a songwriter that good since I signed Robin Pecknold from Fleet Foxes, and I know that's a big statement to make, but I do believe it. Will Stratton is his name. Thank you, Jeff. Anyone else?
I think that's the time that they're giving us.
Okay, well...
I'd like to just say a big congratulations to 20 years.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
And for answering my email, just on a personal note, answering that email and...
And introducing you to your wife.
Introducing me to Jaron and the Midlake Boys and Fleet Foxes. I remember when you sent me an email saying, "I found these kids on MySpace."
That's true, I did.
"Their music is amazing. Check it out." And that became the Fleet Foxes thing. But congratulations. It's very inspiring. And thanks for including me in all of it.
Oh, well, your friendship is very important to us. Thank you, Jason. Thanks to everyone for coming. Yep. And sorry we're a bit late. Thank you.